Once there was a pretty little girl who lived in a house that had a little garden.
La, 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 la.
They shared good dreams, secrets, memories, every lovely day to go down in history. Forever and ever, everywhere they know.
Hello and welcome to a special interview for The Wire. In 2014 and 15, Tavleen Singh was an admirer and supporter of Narendra Modi. 5 years later, she's amongst his sharpest critics. What's brought on this disappointment, if not disillusionment? A book that's recently been published, and here it is, Messiah Modi, charts the progress of Tavleen's steady disappointment, leading to disenchantment and eventually to disillusionment. And in the book, Tavleen raises a critical question. She asks, is Narendra Modi the Messiah that many had hoped he would be? Well, with me to talk about the book and in particular about her disillusionment is Tavleen Singh herself. Tavleen, I've been an avid reader of your Indian Express column every Sunday. And over the last 3 years, I've noticed a steady disappointment with Narendra Modi, leading to disenchantment and finally culminating in disillusionment. And it's that disillusionment I want to discuss with you today. But let's go back to the very beginning. In 2013-14, you described Modi as a shining comet in a very dark sky. At the time, why did you think of him in those terms?
It was a dark time. As I mentioned in the prologue, it was a situation in which we had the Prime Minister reporting to the President of the Congress Party, which was wrong in the first place. We had really a situation in which the economy was being slowly destroyed by actions that needn't have been taken. I hate socialism. And this was a return to socialism after the reforms of the that Manmohan Singh brought, which really made the only difference that we have seen in India economically, was those reforms. And then he himself changed into a socialist. So it was a dark time. There were these huge welfare schemes that couldn't be funded, and that were, I believe in free markets and in liberal democracy, I saw that we were in a really bad situation. So when Modi started to talk about how government has no business to be in business, when he said that we have to think of India as aiming for prosperity instead of just, anti-poverty schemes, I it was music to my ears. And, this is why I supported him.
So in a very real sense, Modi's stress on parivartan, which is so much a part of his rhetoric in 2014-15, made you believe that, in fact, this man believes in economically liberalizing reform. And more importantly, he believes in undoing the stranglehold of government regulation.
Absolutely.
This drew you to him.
Oh, absolutely. Because I really believe that India should be the richest country in the world. Just out of tourism, Karan, our poorest states would become rich, right? Orissa, for instance, could be Bali in 5 minutes if tourism was promoted.
And Modi's rhetoric suggested he understood that.
He was the first prime minister to talk about tourism as an important pillar of the economy. He did nothing about
it. Which is why Modi's stress on parivartan struck a chord.
Yes, as it did with the people of India. It was a choice of the people of India, not just me.
There was another strand to Modi that I think you found attractive, judging by your early columns of the time, and that was the fact that Modi kept talking about changing the political culture of Delhi.
Exactly.
And you saw this as a break with the Lachan stress on entitlement, birth, privilege.
Exactly. You and I come from an elite, which I really have very little respect for, because the way that I grew up, I didn't even know that India was a poor country for most of until I became a journalist, right? I really despise an education system that continues to produce colonial creatures like us, colonized creatures like us. So, I was really hoping that the reforms would go beyond just the economy and go to the education system. The justice system doesn't work. We shouldn't be a country where we still don't have modern highways. I really believed that he would bring parivartan and vikas in that sense.
And in fact, you believe something else as well, that Modi's change of the political culture would mean a new type of Indian would be ruling India, an Indian rooted in India,
exactly,
rather than products of British colonialism,
correct,
deracinated, who couldn't speak their own language.
Couldn't speak their own language.
This you found very attractive.
Yes.
Modi reflected a new India to you.
Yes, absolutely. And my first disappointment, and I went to speak about this to our friend, our late friend Arun Jaitley, I said, why are they just moving into those bungalows in Lutyens' Delhi? Why don't they, you know, I thought that he despised Lutyens' Delhi and what he calls the Khan Market Gang. But now all that's happened is that they've moved out one elite and brought in a new elite.
Absolutely. But before we come to the disappointment and disillusionment, just let me confirm one thing. Your attraction, therefore, to Modi was because in the end you saw him as a new type of politician.
Yes.
Who would reform the political culture as well as change the economy.
Exactly.
In other words, he represented a second start for India.
Yes. I really believed that that would happen under him.
Which is why you called him a shining comet in a very dark night.
Yes.
But he was, in fact, the brightness that would usher forth a new day, a new dawn.
Yes. I thought that he was really giving India its first chance at a new kind of leader since Nehru.
In which case, let's at this point come to when disappointment begins to set in. The first hints of disappointment in your column, and that's also reflected in your book, occur when demonetization happens in November 2016. And this is, in fact, what you write in your book. Demonetization was as if he had taken the decision to suddenly throw a nuclear bomb into the Indian economy merely as an exhibition of his personal power, just because he had the power to do it. In your eyes, this was a disastrous step for which you could find no explanation, and you couldn't for the life of your fathom why has he done it.
Exactly. And you see, the way that the manner in which it was done really gave me, it had a hint of megalomania in it. Because, you know, to suddenly decide one day, you lock up the cabinet ministers and you make that decision without consulting the people who should be consulted before a decision like this is made. And you just announce that, you know, I mean, tomorrow, but from tomorrow you have no money, in fact. He cancelled 86 or 87% of the currency. So I actually, that really worried me. Because, you know, megalomania is to me a very dangerous quality in a man. And I began to see that there was more than a hint of it in that decision.
And in addition to the megalomania, which must have disturbed you, did you also wonder, on whose economic advice has he done this?
Well, you see, I'd already begun to worry about that because I don't want to mention any names, but a few ex-bureaucrats who've been finance secretaries and, you know, who are very fine economists as well, had already told me that they'd actually approached him to try and give him a hint of the kind of reforms that he could make. And they said, we came away thinking he feels he knows everything. So, you know, I mean, I already was aware that he wasn't consulting anyone. And, you know, my political friends were telling me that he was talking to chief secretaries and not chief ministers. You know, he would have these bi-weekly or bi-monthly. What is it when it's twice a month?
Bi-monthly.
Yeah. He would have these conferences and the chief minister would suddenly find the chief secretary saying, sorry, I have to go because the prime minister wants to speak to me. Now, all of that began to, you know, I was already worried, but still hopeful.
And the worst was that not only was he megalomaniacal in the way he did demonetization, but it seemed to you that he'd done it without a firm understanding of the economy, without consulting people he should have, and without realizing what the consequences would be.
Exactly. I think that he really did not anticipate the amount of damage that it was going to do to the economy, to an economy which I think half of it is in the unorganized sector.
So this was megalomania in a state of ignorance.
Yes, it was. It showed that he was too, and I'd already begun to worry about that, too sure that what he thought he was the Messiah, in fact. You know, I mean, I began to see signs of that, and that's always worrying.
Now, in fact, demonetization suggested something else to you, which added to your disappointment. You write, it was a clear sign that Modi was obsessed with black money,
yeah,
rather than liberalizing the economy.
Yes. And I really would like to see a time when the state is withdrawn from areas of economic activity, because the only time that we have created really a change was when that was done with the ending of the License Raj. Now, they ended the License Raj. It was just that one step. And you suddenly had 300 million middle class.
But Modi wasn't doing that.
Modi, I kept hoping, would do much more. And then I think that he, you know, he started off quite well. He said he was going to throw Narega under the bus. And then suddenly he was putting more money into it. And so he was going on exactly the path that the Congress Party had laid out. And you know, the fact that he got scared off by that suit boot remark was also worrying.
I'll come to suit boot in a moment's time, but you're saying to me that you'd hoped for liberalizing economic reform, you'd hoped for
free
loosening of regulation.
Free markets.
But Modi instead was walking the same path that Congress has walked. And if anything, demonetization was not just megalomania, it was the worst example of the state asserting itself over the economy.
Showing people the power that it had. You know, it was like a sledgehammer on many businesses, as you know as well as I do.
And were still taken in economic ignorance by a prime minister who wasn't aware what the consequences would
exactly.
be. Exactly. This disappointment came all the way through virtually to disillusionment when the lynchings began, and you talk specifically of the lynching of Pehlu Khan in April 2017. You write, it became the moment when I began to seriously question my support of Modi. That really made you sit up and say, is this the man I thought he was?
Well, not since the violence in 1984, where I saw bodies of six lying in the streets of Delhi, have I actually seen public violence. You know, I mean, this was one man and his two sons. And you've seen the video. You know, he was beaten to death in public, in a highway town that's halfway between Delhi and Jaipur. And to me, that was horrific.
And worse still, the
defense
videoed it and put it online.
They were proud of
what they did.
Yep. They were proud. So they knew they had sanction for what they did. And this was confirmed the next day. And you know, at that point, a childhood friend of mine was the chief minister of Rajasthan. And I actually talked to her. And I said, what are you doing? And she said, we arrested everybody. I said, you've arrested. It's like a kind of sham arrest, because the Home Minister then said there are two sides to this story. What's the other side to beating a man to death?
Can there be another side?
I mean, what kind of country are we living in if there is another side?
In fact, your book reveals that it wasn't just the lynching. In fact, I should say not one lynching, but spate of lynchings that disturbed you. What perhaps shook you even further was that Modi was silent.
Yeah.
You write, everyone expected that the Prime Minister would say something to indicate that he did not approve of what had happened. He said nothing, not one word. His silence was seen by violent proponents of Hindutva as secret approval. Why do you think he was silent?
I think that he knew that his base wanted this to happen. This was what they considered an assertion of the Hindu Kshatriya Dharma. Now, I know a lot of RSS people have been hoping, because, you know, they believe that the Hindu needs to reassert himself this way. But this is not Kshatriyism, this is cowardice, because, you know, when you're in a mob and you kill one man, one old man, or, you know, two young boys, that's not bravery. I come from, you know, a warrior tribe. And I know that that is cowardice. But when I spoke to an RSS man, who I don't wish to name, after the first of the lynchings, he said, kam az kam Hindu ab mar to raha hai. And that worried me, because I knew then, I connected the two.
And you feared that this kam se kam ab Hindu to mar raha hai as something that Modi may have accepted, may have internalized, which is one reason why he was quiet.
Yes, because his alma mater is the RSS. He's had no education, really.
He wasn't prepared to go against the RSS on this issue.
He's been bred on this idea. And if you know RSS people and talk to them, you'll see that it's their burning desire to see the Hindus fight back. But, you know, a mob is not fighting back.
But in fact, there's something else you said that also disturbed you about Modi's silence. You said that he believed that his supporters, maybe just fringe supporters, believed this was right, and he didn't have the strength of character to tell his supporters this is wrong because he risked losing the support.
I haven't written that.
But you suggested that in your answer just now.
Yeah, well, you see, when I went to see him, which I described that one meeting that I had with him, one-to-one, after he became prime minister, I said to him, why aren't you saying anything? And he said, roz is desh mein kuch na kuch ho raha hota hai, to main roz kaise bol sakunga? But actually, the only time he spoke was when two Dalits were killed.
And he wasn't prepared to stand up for the right thing at the cost of losing supporters. He preferred to keep quiet and let people think he supported what his supporters were doing rather than stand up for right.
Exactly. And that's cynicism. And you know as well as I do, when politicians start exhibiting cynicism, it's very, very scary.
In fact, this raises a deeper question. It's one that you didn't address in your book or in your columns, but I'm sure you've thought about. This is an issue actually of the Prime Minister's moral leadership.
Yes.
You know, and I know, in any democracy, at a time when the country is anguished, you look to your leaders to take a stand around which the country can rally.
Yeah.
Here was a need for Modi to do that, but he ducked it. Is it because he didn't want to, or he didn't know how to?
I think he didn't want to, because when they started to kill the Dalits, because also part of his education would have been the fact that the Hindus are a monolith. You know, that the caste system is bad. This is also an RSS idea. And that the Dalits must not be, there should be untouchability is a bad thing, etc. And so it was only when the Dalits were beaten up in Una, I think that's the name of the place.
That's right, Gujarat.
Where they tied him to a, tied them to a, and they were, you know, skinning a dead cow. And that was the first time he spoke out. And he said, these Gaurakshaks are doing very bad things. But again, it was a very ambiguous kind of thing that he said, because he said many of them are just criminals disguised as Gaurakshaks, which said to me that, you know, Gaurakshya for him was actually a fundamental belief.
But the very important thing is the way you began that answer just now. You think that Modi didn't want to exercise moral leadership because he was worried that the political costs in terms of his supporters would be unfortunate, and he didn't want to incur that.
Yeah, well, you see, I don't believe that he won either the first time or the second time because of Hindutva. And his not speaking out against barbarism, you know,
was losing people like you.
Was losing people like me, who believed that he was at, that he was telling the truth when he talked of Parivartan and Vikas.
Didn't speak out against barbarism.
It is barbarism. It is barbarism.
Something that instinctively any good politician should do, but Modi didn't, because actually he wanted to protect people he thought were voters for him.
Exactly.
The choice was between protecting my voters, speaking out against barbarism, and he chose to protect his voters instead.
And also, it seems as though he was protecting one of his fundamental beliefs. That worried me even more.
Because the fear that he shared this belief that
he shared
voters
this
had
belief.
Shown.
Yeah.
That's even worse.
That worried me.
That truly must have made you think, have I at all understood this man, or have I completely misunderstood
now,
him?
Now, you know, I've seen barbarism before under secular leaders, right? And sometimes they've justified it, etc. But it's not in the DNA of secular political parties to actually go around killing people.
You feared it might be in the DNA of Modi supporters to
do this. It is in the DNA of the RSS to revive the Hindu pride through killing Muslims. They have an obsession with this.
And this is why it particularly worried you, because you wondered, is the Prime Minister I'm supporting part of this DNA?
Yes, I believed that he was not. And,
but
you know,
the fear had entered your mind that he might be.
Yes.
And his silence was, in fact, in a sense, one reason why you were deeply perturbed, because you couldn't understand, why is the man not speaking up?
Yeah.
Now, your book indicates that there were two other further strands to your disillusionment. The first was that suit with his name woven all over it, which he wore when Barack Obama came in January 2015. As you write in your book, till that point, you'd believe there was a spiritual dimension to the man. He wasn't acquisitive. He wasn't into acquiring possessions. But this suit showed you that actually there was a streak of vanity in him, even perhaps hypocrisy. And that also turned you off.
Yeah. You see, when I met him the first time for a private interview was in 2013, when I was summoned to Ahmedabad to have a kind of one. And, you know, it was the room in which we had this meeting. It was the chief minister's office. And it had Chinese, what are they called? The little Chinese bamboos of good luck. And it was absolutely bare. It was like a kind of meditation center. So, and when I asked him then what he would have been if he hadn't been a politician, he said, I would have been in the Himalayas as a sadhu, you know, as an ascetic. And I believed that. And I think that there is a spiritual side to him, which is why I continue to hope.
And then suddenly the man appears in a very expensive suit with his name woven across
it. Yeah, I mean, that's vanity beyond vanity now.
And suddenly you said to yourself, this image that he gave when I met him in Ahmedabad, that I'm not into worldly goods, that if I wasn't a politician, I'd have been a hermit in the Himalayas. Yeah. Actually, that wasn't true. This man likes possessions, particularly his name on his suit.
Yeah, it seemed that way to me.
The second thing that emerges from your book that destroyed your faith in Mr. Modi is the fact that he chose Yogi Adityanath as chief minister of a critical state, Uttar Pradesh. You write, to unleash a Hindu fanatic upon India's electorally most important state seemed not just stupidity, but madness.
Yes.
You simply couldn't understand why he'd done it.
Completely couldn't understand it. And I went off then to Gorakhpur, because when I started, you know, writing against this, people said, go and see, he's done a lot in Gorakhpur. And he's won 5 times. He's never lost an election there. And when I went there, I was even more horrified, because actually Gorakhpur looks like one of the worst places in India in terms of cleanliness, beauty, anything. I mean, there's not a single aesthetically appealing thing about it. And then on top of that, I talked to people who were in the Hindu Yuva Vahini, which I also mentioned, who said that they'd all joined politics with the idea of protecting Hindu women from Muslim men. And, you know, really, I began to wonder where we're going. I'm still wondering.
And once again, you said to yourself, if Modi chooses a man like Yogi Adityanath to be chief minister of a critical state, then this puts into question not only the faith that I had in Modi and Parivartan, Modi and changing political culture, but it also makes me wonder, does Modi actually support the views of a man like Adityanath?
Of a man like Yogi Adityanath. Now, I hear that it was the pressure from the MLAs of UP, and I think that might be true to some extent, that
but
they
Modi
wanted.
Modi should have resisted it.
Modi should have said no. You know, I sabka saath, sabka vishwas, vikas vagaira, and I'm not going to have him because he's been openly anti-Muslim in almost everything he's done. The first thing he did were those little Romeo squads or whatever they were. It was love jihad he went after. Then the killings, the lynchings increased.
And once again, the fear in your mind, does Modi subtly, quietly agree with Yogi Adityanath's anti-Muslim stand?
Yeah.
Otherwise, why is he putting this man
there? And it hasn't helped, as we've seen. It's not as if UP has boomed, you know, under him in any way or blossomed.
So Yogi Adityanath was another very disillusioning moment
for
you.
Very disillusioning moment for me.
Let's take a break at that point. When I come back, I want to turn to two critical developments that happened in the last 6 months of 2019. As I read your book, I get the feeling that those two became for you tipping points. I'm going to take a break and come back to that. But first, a message from our sponsor, Glenlivet, whilst I take a refreshing sip from this glass.
Take a little trip with me, I'm gonna take you home.
Take a little history.
Take a little.
Down this lane of memories.
Down this lane.
So let's raise another glass for the glorious past and the friends we have become. Yeah. Cause little did we know, the good times come and go, but the best is yet to come.
Welcome back to a special interview for The Wire with Tavleen Singh, whose book on Narendra Modi has recently been published. Here it is. It's called Messiah Modi, and it charts the journey of her thinking about the Prime Minister from a supporter in 2014-15 to someone who's amongst his sharpest critics today. And she raises a critical question. Is Modi the Messiah that many had hoped he would be? Tavleen, I want to come now to two decisive events in the last 6 months of 2019, which I believe were tipping points in your thinking. And they turned you from a person who was beginning to question to a person who became completely disillusioned with Narendra Modi. The first was, in fact, the way Article 370 was abrogated. You write in your book, it could and should have been done by convincing Kashmiris that it was in their best interest. The abrogation could have been done with more grace. And then you go on to say, there was no need for it to be used as a test of patriotism in the Maharashtra and Haryana elections. You know Kashmir very well. And I know that you believe that abrogating it was the right thing to do. But the way in which it was done put you off Modi.
And the campaign that followed. I was in Maharashtra and I was quite horrified at the fact that they considered this a great achievement. And to make it a great achievement, they were putting on target the whole of Kashmir with every Kashmiri Muslim as a traitor almost.
And they, not realizing they were doing this.
Yeah, I think that they knew what they were doing. You know, it's pretty clear they don't like Muslims much, you know. I mean, but the fact is that the political parties that have supported India, that have kept India in Kashmir, that have constantly, the leaders of those parties are locked up now. And they're trying to create a new leadership. And they feel that they can do this by just development. But who's going to invest in Kashmir if you've got locked down for 6 months?
And you saw this almost unthinking attitude to Kashmir as playing with fire.
Not just playing with fire. Again, what is worrying, what worried me was the ignorance that it indicated. Do you know, just as a demonetization, they'd ignored the advice they could have had from economists. They could have brought in people who've worked in Kashmir, worked with the Kashmiri people, given them a deeper idea of the complexity of the Kashmir problem. They did nothing. They just decided one day that they would do this with a presidential order, to do it with, and with the governor being a willing hatchet man in the job. So, you know, and look what we've got. We've got 6 months of Kashmir in lockdown. The image of India as a liberal democracy has taken a huge hit. Pakistan's run away with the story on having a case in Kashmir. They'd lost that case. They'd lost it long ago. And the Kashmiris themselves, who'd gone off any idea of secession, started with the hanging of Bhutto and the Bangladesh war. That's when they began to lose interest in Pakistan. And I remember Farooq Abdullah saying to me once, he said, the choice of a secular democratic India against an Islamic Pakistan, for us, there's no choice.
And Modi has dangerously reversed that whole
exactly.
line of thinking.
Exactly.
So when you say Modi acted in ignorance, didn't get advice from people who know Kashmir, it's not just that there was a better way of handling 370 and bringing the Kashmiris on board, but...
I believe it should go, by the
way. But worst is that he's actually given a huge fillip and boost to Imran Khan and Pakistani propaganda. He's made the Kashmiris think twice about
He's made Pakistan. Internationalized an issue that had become a domestic issue.
So he's lost on every count.
I think that he's lost on every count. And I think that the recovery, I've talked to Kashmiris who come down and, you know, the recovery is going to take a very, very long time.
So this is an instance of the right thing, but done in the worst possible way.
Exactly.
And the consequences of doing it in the worst possible way perhaps undermine the fact you've done the right thing.
And the consequences for the rest of India are huge. You know, the Kashmiri Muslim has very little to do with the Indian Muslim. With the rest of the Indian Muslim, let's say that. And they don't even have much intermarriage, right? But the other day, I met a Kashmiri, who I don't wish to name, who said to me, he said, suddenly you've made us all Muslims. This was before the citizen thing started.
So India will, for a long time to come, pay the cost of Modi's ignorance in how to handle Kashmir.
Well, it's been handled very badly.
In a sense, when I read your book, what perhaps is the straw that broke the camel's back, if I can use that phrase, and that completely disillusioned you, was the Citizenship Amendment Act. You call it India's first Nuremberg law. You are seriously equating Modi legislation with Nazi legislation.
Let's not put it quite that way, but certainly the Nuremberg laws, without the Nuremberg laws, you wouldn't have had the gas chambers. Because the first thing they did, the Nazis, was to weaponize citizenship. Jews were not allowed to be considered citizens, or they had to do various things. They were excluded from being normal German citizens. And to me, this is, you know, when you say over and over again, Sikhs, Buddhists, Jains, Parsis, Christians, all of these people will be allowed in, except Muslims, right? And they've whipped up this kind of frenzy on certain television channels, where the other day I had someone say to me, are you saying we should allow Pakistani Muslims into, not a Pakistani Muslim will come here? I am the voice of the new India. Now, for a start, Pakistan is, we've had big problems with Pakistan, but it's not a dirty word, Pakistani. It's somebody with whom Mr. Modi himself was trying to negotiate. And now suddenly in, you know, in elections, you're talking about this being an Indo-Pakistan match because there were Muslims sitting in Shaheen Bagh.
So as you say, this law, the Citizenship Amendment Act, actually treats Muslims as different.
Yes.
It doesn't treat them equally with people of other religions. And as you said, that's precisely what
the message these people have got.
And that's precisely what the Nuremberg laws did to the Jews.
Exactly.
Treated them as different.
Treated them, gave them a warning. You know, after the Nuremberg laws came the boycott of Jewish shops and establishments. And then came a time when the Jews could neither leave nor stay. And the confiscation of properties. Now, you're already seeing...
Do you fear something like that could happen?
Well, I'm very worried about this confiscation of properties in UP on the basis of facial recognition. Facial recognition doesn't even work in the West perfectly at the moment. And there are posters up in Uttar Pradesh with pictures of people seen in crowds who stand to lose their property.
In fact, a poet called Inam Pratapgari is now being charged by the police with 1.4 crore.
Can you imagine?
Because the police were deflected to give security when he was carrying out rallies.
Now, you tell me if there shouldn't be, you know, reason for all of us to worry about where this is going.
So now we're sort of charting a potential progress. First, you treat Muslims as different. You separate them from everyone else. Then you begin to charge them for their property because of rioting that's happened and confiscate their property. And both of these are similar to you, to
and
what happened to the Jews.
And the people who understood this are the ordinary Muslims.
So we're sliding down that road. We all hope we don't go that far.
That's why hope against hope.
That road is sliding in the wrong way.
I still believe that the Prime Minister has it in himself to stop this slide. You know, because, I mean, surely he's got the message.
But does he? Because actually, I was going to point out to you that your book clearly suggests that the Citizenship Amendment Act, in a sense, symbolizes Modi's attitude to Muslims. Because you're right, since the beginning of Modi's second term, it can no longer be said that Muslims have the same rights as other citizens. In almost everything that the government has done, whether in Kashmir or in its determination to make a national register of citizens, it has been made clear that if you are Muslim, you could find it difficult to call yourself Indian.
I have to say very sadly that I do believe that this is true. And I've been in Shaheen Bagh and talked to those women and was very impressed with how deeply they have understood what is being done. They've seen the weaponization of citizenship. And you cannot do that in India. You cannot do that.
Can I ask you this? When you say that since the beginning of Modi's second term, it can no longer be said that Muslims have the same rights as other citizens, I'm being blunt. But you're actually suggesting that Modi is prejudiced against Muslims and he doesn't treat them as equals.
There were hints of that earlier. There was that incident with the cap where he wouldn't wear a Muslim cap. There was that very insensitive comment about if a Muslim dies, you know, I mean, a puppy coming under the wheel of a car, even that hurts me. And there have been signs of this insensitivity. But you see, I know the RSS very well. I understand their thinking very well because I've been covering them since, you know.
And they don't hide the fact that they don't like Muslims.
No, they don't hide it at all. I used to go to these, and this was, you know, when I was a reporter in The Statesman, I used to go to these, the shakhas in the morning, and then over breakfast afterwards, they would say, they breed like rabbits. And these were Punjabi refugees. I'm a Punjabi refugee. My family comes from the other side. And, you know, I was really surprised at how the sense of grievance was so deep with Muslims.
So if the RSS doesn't hide their dislike, their antipathy to Muslims, the CA has revealed that perhaps, Modi is much the same.
Well, there were those speeches of the Home Minister that made it quite clear, no?
And Mr. Modi, when he said you can recognize the protesters from their clothes.
Yes.
Or when he said that Shaheen Bagh is a conspiracy.
Exactly. So, you know, I mean, I keep trying to make a distinction between the Home Minister and the Prime Minister. But, you know, I'm just doing it in the hope that there is a difference. And, you know,
But you said a very interesting thing. There were hints that Modi doesn't like Muslims when that incident with the cap happened or his remark about a puppy under a car.
Because
now those hints are becoming much more like certain statements that he doesn't like Muslims.
His alma mater, the place where he got his entire education, it's part of their DNA, the RSS. They don't like Muslims.
And once again, you fear this is part of Modi's DNA too.
I'm getting a little bit worried that it might be.
And he can't hide it any longer.
And people are seeing it.
I'm coming to the end of this interview, but in your epilogue, there is a sentence which suggests that you are deeply worried about the future of India. You write, I find myself wondering if India is now on the verge of changing irrevocably into an illiberal democracy instead of one that prided itself on its liberalism and its tolerance. Yeah. Do you blame Mr. Modi for this?
Well, it's happened in the past. You know, for a start, the infrastructure for all this to happen was set up by secular leaders in the past 70 years for banning of books, for controlling the media. All that infrastructure existed. But certainly in the past 6 years, there's a change in the atmosphere. There is things said openly in polite society that never could be said before about Muslims. You know, there is an equating of Muslims. There's this talk of blaming every Muslim today for partition that is more and more heard, particularly in the television channels that are now the Doordarshan of this government, you know. There are many, as you know.
And then I suppose you can add to that the fact that the BJP doesn't have a single Muslim MP in the Lok Sabha.
Yeah.
It doesn't have a single Muslim MLA in Uttar Pradesh with a 20% Muslim population. And I believe since 85, it hasn't fielded a single Muslim in any election, state or central in Gujarat. Not a single one.
I didn't know that. But I think that the fact that they won twice without the Muslim vote embolden them to go ahead with an agenda that people like the Prime Minister and the Home Minister would have been taught from the time that they were small, because they went as children.
So we can win without Muslims, so we don't need to care what Muslims think.
We don't care what Muslims.
So we'll do to them whatever we want.
And again, the ignorance. You can do that with the Sikhs. At one point, they try. You know, it happened with the Sikhs. With Sikhs, you know, less than 20 million. You can't do it with 200 million people. And, you know, the fear that's been created is only beginning to be seen, you know, in these Shaheen Bagh-type protests that are going on across the country.
But you're saying an important thing. Modi's attitude, particularly to Muslims, is making India slowly but steadily an illiberal democracy.
There are signs already that we're on the verge of becoming an illiberal democracy, not just because of the Muslims, but because of the way the media is being managed, and because of this complete allergy to any kind of criticism, any kind of dissent. You know, there are the students that were protesting against this law in New York City were his supporters just the other day. And apparently there were so many outside the consulate on Republic Day that they moved on to Fifth Avenue. And, you know, there were protests going on everywhere. And he said, this is a plot. This is a plot against India. And again, you know, this whole...
So Modi is changing India. He's just changing it not the way you want
exactly,
it to change.
Exactly. It's the kind of parivartan that we hope stops right now.
I want to, at this point, remind you of something you wrote in your column on the 10th of January 2014, 4 months before Modi got first elected. You wrote, and I'm quoting, "Will someone please explain to me what is it about Modi that makes so many people believe that he could wreck India?" You'd never ask that question today. You've got the answer, haven't you?
Yeah, well, I'm still, that's why the epilogue is called Hope Against Hope, because I'm still hoping that he stops this agenda from going another step forward and that he goes back to his promise of prosperity and, and development.
You call your last chapter Hope Against Hope. That is the evocative title of Ossip Mandelstam's searing poem.
That's where I got it from.
And no, remember, it's Ossip from died hoping, but actually
it's from Nadezhda Mandelstam's book.
Absolutely. So this is what I'm saying. Yeah. You're hoping against hope.
Yes.
But in your heart, aren't you aware that you're not going to see what you want? You've seen the change, but it's not the change you wanted.
Well, this country is changing into a country that I'm really very unhappy with, because I always, when I used to go to Pakistan and come back here, I always felt, look at us. And the Pakistani friends that I have, and there are many, and I'm proud of them, they're perfectly liberal people. They would come to India and say, look what we missed out on. And now I'm not sure that they would say that anymore.
In fact, now they say, tum to bilkul hamare jaise hi nikle.
Exactly.
Then let me end by putting this to you. You say in your book, and you raise this as a question, and you consciously say, I'm not answering it. Is Modi the messiah many people hoped he would be? You didn't answer it in your book, but you've answered it in this interview. He's clearly not the messiah you believed in.
Well, that's why there's a question mark in the title of the book.
He's not, at the end of this conversation, feels only rhetorical. Everyone's got the answer from you.
Well, the book, I think, answers it in that way, but I still think that he is a wise, clever politician, and I hope he realizes that the road that he's taking is the wrong one.
This is hope against hope.
Hope against hope.
I've left this deliberately, consciously, and purposely to the end, because I think it was only fair that you should explain your disillusionment and how it's gone from disappointment through disenchantment to disillusionment before I ask you this question. There are many who are going to say, Tavleen is only angry because of what Modi has done to her sense, Atish, and the way her son's overseas citizenship was removed virtually overnight. That this is not a thinking journalist, this is the bitterness of a mother that's coming out. How do you respond to that?
Well, as a mother, I'm devastated by what they've done. But the book could not have been written in 8 weeks. I'm really fast as a writer, but nobody can write a book of nearly 100,000 words between August and January. It's not possible. So those who say that know that what happened to Atish is wrong, because it was also the weaponization of citizenship. And they know perfectly well that he grew up in India, that he was my legal ward, that he never saw his father till he was 22, and that when he was asked about, when I actually applied for the PIO, they didn't ask me whether he had a Pakistani father. I would have told them. I actually mentioned the name of the father in the thing. So nobody lied to them. And when Atish was asked to, online to change the PIO to an OCI, and they asked what his nationality, or the nationality of his father, I said, say he was British, he had a British passport, and he's dead. He'd been dead 6 years. There was no way for us to know.
So do you think the opposite is true? Not the allegation that she's turned against Modi because Modi took action against her son, but that in fact Modi took action against your son because you've been steadily becoming a critic.
Well, thank you for saying that, because actually that is the truth. That is the truth. I think that Atish's article in Time magazine, after which they suddenly discovered that he didn't deserve an OCI, they also want to blacklist him. What they're trying to do is make sure he never comes to India again. But I think that the part of the target was me, because they felt that I had let them down.
So Atish paid the price, but the
Atish paid the price for his own article. Because
part of the anger is anger against you.
I think so.
Tavleen Singh, a pleasure talking to you.
A pleasure being here, Karan.
To receive instant updates on all videos from The Wire, click the subscribe button and hit the bell icon. Pay to support independent journalism. Click the link in the description and choose the amount you want to pay.